learned to praise today. As good as it is, as blessing as it is, it's hard, right? We're praying for a worship leader. So if you got the goods, if you got the heart, volunteer. Brian, you're baptized, so you qualify, all right? You can lead the praise, just in a good heart, all right? And if you don't volunteer, I'm going to call on you, right? I was just talking to Christine and Peter today, and you're going to lead the praise. But we're praying for a worship leader, a consistent worship leader, so please pray for that. I do have some people in mind, but if you have heart, any heart to lead us in worship, please let me know, okay? And so we're praying for that. And also, as mentioned, the membership class is starting today, okay? English ministry is members only, all right? Exclusive fite, you know what I'm talking about? You got to be qualified to be a member of this club, you know? You need to know the word, right? And, but in all seriousness, the membership class is going to focus on knowing the heart of God. You know, we want to live a good Christian life. And what does that mean? Good Christian life is doing what pleases God. And if we want to please God, we need to know what He likes and what He dislikes. Do you know what He likes and dislikes? If you don't know what He likes and dislikes, if you don't know His heart, how can you please Him? And that's what this study is all about. What is God's heart? What does He like? And what does He dislike? And so we can begin to live as a good shepherd, right? As a shepherd, you know, serving God, and also as a good sheep of Christ. Someone who listens to Christ, who obeys Christ, and does what He wants. Good sheep, good shepherd. That's the goal of this membership class. So I want to encourage you. And this membership class is actually training, is a training for you to be leaders of this English ministry, okay? And the reason why we don't have, like, small groups right now is because we don't have leaders. We don't have leaders who are ready to lead as a shepherd, okay? And so this membership class is going to teach you from the Bible, in depth from the Bible, what it means to be a shepherd of Christ and a sheep of Christ, so that we could have leaders in this English ministry, and you guys can, you, the lay people, can begin to really lead this ministry. You know, when a ministry is led by a pastor only, there's a limit, and it will not grow. There's a limit to what the pastor too can do, right? Like today, I had to prepare for praise, I had to prepare for the message, and I had to prepare for the members' class. I thought I was going to go crazy. Oh my gosh, who am I, right? But sometimes, you know, pastor has to do those things. So that's not the way a ministry should be run. It's the you guys, the members who are leading the ministry. And so this class is going to prepare you, right? We can't just all of a sudden become leaders. It prepares you. And I know some of you college guys, you guys are busy. You have a midterm. Let me ask you, what's more important? God or school? Let me just ask you that question. Really. God or school? Your soul or your biology class? Okay? So, it's just 2 hours. See? Somebody agrees with me back there. It's just 2 hours. A little bit less than 2 hours of your time for your soul and for God and for this ministry and how God can use you. But don't be guilty if you don't come. Because I've already prayed and I asked God to give in your heart a desire for this. Okay? So if you don't have a desire, God didn't call you. You can take it next time. Okay? But if you're interested and you want to learn a little bit more deeper, come to this membership class today. Okay? And for the message today, I want to talk a little bit about what worship is, okay? And, you know, what is worship? You know, when we come to worship, what are we supposed to do? You know, what is it all about? You know, sometimes we wonder, you know, all the things that we're doing, that we're singing, you know, is it acceptable to God? You know, what is worship? And I went to Center Street Church yesterday. I was like, hey, there's Center Street Church. Why are we coming here? Right? It's like this awesome building. You know, you walk in. Has anyone been there? Raise your hand if you've been there. Center Street Church. They have a waterfall inside the building, right? Just for the waterfall, people should go. This big waterfall right in front of the sanctuary. I'm like, holy cow. And their information desk is just like, this awesome, you know? It's like, just so awesome. I can't even describe how awesome it is. They have just this design. They have a cafe as you walk in. You know, I'm like, I feel like I'm in Starbucks. I'm like, why are people, you know? Walk into the sanctuary, there's this little light. It's just awesome. But is that what worship is? You know, we tend to focus, when we come to church, the surroundings, you know, the building. Oh, okay, what is the building like? What we see, you know, all these little paraphernalia, the music, you know, and stuff like that. We focus on all these things, the music, you know, the seats, and we're so easily distracted by these things. And so today I want to talk about worship and what worship is. The heart of worship we read from Isaiah chapter 29, verses 13 and 14. And everybody worships something or someone. And that's because we were made to worship. We were made spiritual beings to worship. We seek something divine, something transcendent, something greater than who we are. That's what we are made for. See, God created us. The Bible says God created us in His image. It's not the physical image it's talking about, right? If it's not the physical image, what are we created? We are created as God is spirit. We are created also spiritual beings. We only see the physical, we don't see the spiritual, so we don't focus on the spiritual side of who we are, but we are spiritual beings. And as spiritual beings, we seek the spiritual things. We seek the transcendent things, the divine things. And because we don't know where to look, we look to other things in this world to fill that void and that emptiness only which God can fill. And so we are worshiping other things than God. Okay? And Tim Keller, Pastor Tim Keller says, when you're alone, no one's looking, what's the first thing that you turn to? What's the first thing that you turn to? That's probably the thing that you worship. What's the first thing that kind of comes to your mind consistently? That's probably the first thing. That's probably the thing that's consuming you. And the Old Testament calls it idolatry. Idolatry. But God said, don't have other gods before me. Because He knows that we're inclined, because we're spiritual beings, we're made in God's image, we're inclined to seek some things greater than who we are, right? And so, I don't know what things that you consume yourself with in your hearts, but St. Augustine, one of the great theologians in the past, St. Augustine said this, you know, our hearts are restless. Our hearts are restless until it finds its rest in you. Our hearts are not satisfied until it finds its rest in you. So everybody worships something or someone, okay? But the problem is it God? All right? Is it God? Is it God that we worship? So I want to cover these things. What is worship? What exactly is it? Why is it important in our life? And how are we to truly worship? What is God looking for when we come to church? What does He want? Okay? So what is worship? Worship involves drawing near to God. That's one aspect. Okay? And when we worship other things than God, other things, we're drawing near to something. Okay? Our hearts are drawing near. The passage today, Isaiah chapter 29, verse 13 says, because this people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far from me. Okay? Isaiah is prophesying about the people that he sees. Okay? All the people, all the Israelites, all the worshipers, they're with their mouth, they say, oh, God is good. With their mouth, with their lips, they're drawing near, right? Drawing near is a sense of worshiping, but their hearts are far, near and far. Okay? So there's a sense of a drawing near to God as what when we worship. Okay? 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 29 says, ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. And we're coming before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Okay? And so, you know, Center Street Church, as grand as it is, you know, as grand as it is, when I walked in, I didn't sense the presence of God there. Just personally. I didn't sense God's presence. Okay, I don't know why. Maybe something was wrong with me. But it says the Spirit of God just drawing me near to him. Okay? And when we worship, that's going to happen. Okay? But what do we do when we're distracted and in our hearts, we're just not drawn toward God? You know? And we're distracted by all these things. Worship is drawing near to God. It's to God. Okay? It doesn't matter where I am. Okay? It doesn't matter about the people. It doesn't matter if I feel like, you know, I feel like, you know, worshiping God, or I feel like doing something. I feel like seeking God. Okay? Worship is to God. And so you focus on God. Okay? And you're focusing on God. It's to God. You're just singing to God, right? And so when we sing songs and when we're singing God, and you know, some people, you know, they lift their hands and I'm like, whoa, he's lifting his hands. What's he doing? You know? Or, and some of us, we may want to lift our hands, but you know, we're like self-conscious. I wonder what people would think of me. So we lift our hands maybe like this. No one sees, you know. So, but when we worship, just think about God. It's drawing near to God, okay? And it's drawing close to God with our hearts. Verse 13 says, while their hearts are far from me. Okay? It's about our hearts. We're supposed to draw near with our hearts to God. It's not just, you know, singing about God, okay? Our hearts has to be with God. It has to go toward God. And Jesus said, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. And God knew that our hearts are susceptible when we worship. When we worship God, when we worship other things, it's about our hearts, okay? In Deuteronomy chapter 11, 16, it says, take care lest your heart be deceived, and you turn aside and serve other gods and worship them. Deuteronomy 30, 17 says, but if your heart turns away, and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them. See, when we worship God, and when we don't worship God, when we honor God, and when we don't honor God, it's a matter of our hearts. It's a matter of our hearts. Our hearts either is with God or not. Okay? Now, what is this thing we call heart? Okay? It is our innermost being. It is the seat of our desire. It is the core of who we are. And so to worship with our hearts means the external rituals, the things that we do in worship, they don't mean anything if we don't know God, if we don't know God's heart. And to worship God with our hearts, it requires the love of God. What God desires relationship with us. And as in any relationship, He wants our heart, all of our hearts, all of our hearts. Okay? It's a pouring out of our heart, our the core of who we are to God. It's opening heart, open the eyes of my heart, right? And so let me tell you a story of Tim Hughes that illustrates this. And so Tim Hughes, he wrote a Heart of Worship, you know. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. You know that song, right? It's all about you. And so when Tim and his wife Rachel were dating, they started to talk about marriage. And one afternoon together, you know, Rachel shared how much she loved him and said that she knew beyond the shadow of a doubt that he was the one for her. And he wanted to say something equally romantic back to her in response. But all he could hear coming out of his mouth was, Rachel, I am 99% sure I want to marry you as well. 99% sure. And by the way, don't say that to a girl that you're planning to marry or propose. And judging by her reaction, he quickly realized 99% wasn't good enough. So, even in a human relationship, a marriage will work, okay, only if the relationship is prioritized. When the relationship is prioritized, worship happens when we prioritize God over other things. Is God a priority in your life? Worship happens when we put God as our priority and give Him 100%. He needs to become our number one above other ambitions, affection, and activity. And God wants our hearts in worship, right? But, well, you may say, well, why should I love God if He never loved me? And actually, God has loved us. And He's always loved us, and He always wanted a relationship with us. Okay? But we, people, decided to go our way. And we didn't trust God. We didn't know His heart and His unconditional love for us. But God has been relentlessly been pursuing us. And God took on human flesh, and He died on the cross, and He rose from the dead to bring us back to Him, to show us how much He loves us, you see. In the passage we read, God says, this is God speaking, their fear of me, or in other words, their worship of me, is a commandment taught by men. And what God is saying is, here, the people, they're not worshiping God. They're not loving God. They're not wanting to know God. Instead, they have made tradition. They have made their own rules, right? They're worshiping God their own way, okay? And an example is, you know, when the Pharisees, they come to Jesus and they say, hey, how come your disciples, they don't wash their hands before they eat? So that's the tradition. That's the way they worship God, right? They made their own tradition. The tradition is more important. The man-made laws, the laws they made, okay? The rules they made are more important than God, okay? And so God is saying, their fear of me, their worship of me is a commandment taught by men. They're making their own way of worshiping me, okay? They're not following me. They're following their way of worshiping me. Okay? They have created a way to worship God. They have made God into a religion. You see? And Christianity and worshiping Christ, it's not a religion. Okay? It's a relationship. And therefore, God, He says, so this is what God is going to do. Therefore, behold, I will again do wonderful things with this people. One wonder upon wonder. Wisdom of their wise shall perish. Discernment of their discerning men shall be hidden. What does this mean in terms of worship? Okay. This is talking about Jesus Christ. This is talking about what God is going to do on the cross. How God is going to show that when we worship God, we don't come. We don't worship God our way. We don't make up ways to worship God. Okay? We worship God through what God, how God tells us to worship. Okay? And that's through Jesus Christ. It's by grace. It's by God's grace that we approach God. It's through Jesus. We can't bring to God our best or the way we... there's nothing that we can bring to qualify us and make us worship God. You see, God, He wants us to worship Him with our hearts and through Christ to come by faith. Okay, so let me tell you a story that might help you understand. It's a story about a bishop in England. His name is Sandy Miller, and it's the same church that developed the Alpha program. Okay, and he's the leader. He's the former leader of the Holy Trinity Brompton in London, and he tells the story of attending an early Vineyard conference in California, and he was dramatically inspired, right, by all that was going on, and he went for a walk along the beach to pour his heart out to God, and he was thankful for all that God was doing in his church, and so he prayed, and he was suggesting things he could offer up to God to use. But when he asked this question, God, what do you want from me? God, what do you want from me? He felt God clearly say to him, Sandy, all I want is you. All I want is you. When we worship, that's what God wants. He wants us. All He wants is us. He doesn't need for us to offer anything up to Him and, you know, to do anything for Him. So, all God wants is for us to draw near to Him with our hearts. Okay? Now, why is worship important? Worship is important because it's the way we are made holy. Okay? Worship is important because it's the way we are made holy. Okay? Worship, when we worship God, it gets rid of the sin in our lives. Worship is the way we overcome temptation. William Temple wrote this. This world can be saved from political chaos and collapse by one thing, and that is worship. You see, we cannot in and of ourselves get rid of our idols and sins. It's through worship that this happens, okay? And James chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. I don't know if this is the last one. Okay, good, yeah. James chapter 4, verse 7 and 8 says this. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Submit yourselves to God, therefore, to God. Okay. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So if we resist temptation, then is that how the devil flees from you? No. The devil's not scared of us. When we resist the devil, we don't just resist him. We have to resist him and draw near to God. What is it? See, verse 8 says, resist the devil and draw near to God. And when we draw near to God, God draws near to us. And devil flees because he's not fleeing us, he's fleeing God, you see? And when we worship God, when we draw near to God, right? God is the one who cleanses us from sin. God is the one who turns our hearts away from the things that destroy us to worship Him. The things that captivate our hearts, that's not God. God is the one. When we turn to God, when we turn our hearts to God, and God captivates our hearts, He's the one who helps us to overcome sin. You see? And, you know, as you guys know, I took some time off and went to Korea, right? For a couple of weeks. And, man, that was just too long. Too long. Too long of a break. And as a minister, your spiritual faith and ministry, they get kind of tied together. That's kind of bad. So when you take a vacation from ministry, you take a vacation from your faith. Right? That's a danger, okay? Because a lot of the prayer that you do for ministry. A lot of the Bible reading you do for ministry. And so when you take a break from the ministry, you kind of take a break from your faith, so to speak, right? And so that was kind of unhealthy. I found myself, right? And I found myself, you know, just relaxing too much. And coming back from that, back into ministry and transitioning was tough. Let alone the jet lag, right? The jet lag was tough. And I picked up a bad habit of playing this game. I'm kind of ashamed to admit, right? Marvel superheroes. Don't pick it up. It's a contest of champions, right? You can be like Wolverine and Cyclops and Hulk, right? And as you play, you get stronger and stronger. And anyway, you get these gems. And so it became so addictive. And my gosh, what am I doing? And my wife was on me. You're the pester. What are you? I'm like, but I'm Wolverine. Two. And I need two. But that was my idol. You know, that was my idol. That was consuming me. And so morning prayer Saturday, yesterday, I came and I was just praying before God. I was like, God, I'm sorry. You know, it took so much of my time. I wasn't worshiping you with my heart. You know, I was not with you, God. I'm so sorry. And I began to just pray and pour out my heart before God. So as I began to pray and worship God, I began to turn my heart around. You know, so I don't play it as much. Limit myself 30 minutes a day. When my wife is not watching, you know, like when she goes to sleep, I'm like, I could go into my own fantasy world of Marvel superheroes. So, but I couldn't will myself to stop. I had to worship. I had to pray, and I had to turn to God. And you know, something about like prayer meetings, right? It's hard to pray by yourself, isn't it, right? It's really hard. But something about going to a prayer meeting that kind of motivates you. There's the music in the background, right? It's kind of a worshipful atmosphere, right? So sometimes it's good to go to prayer meetings to pray, right? And I don't know if you guys have Christian music. It's good to listen to Christian music too. To go into that mode of worship, you know, to have worship throughout the week by listening to Christian music. And I remember, you know, many times, like, I'm listening to music and the words of the song would just hit my heart, you know, and I'd be like, you know, I'll be driving, right? I'll be on a stop sign, I'll be worshiping God, and I'll be tears be coming down my eyes. I'm like, oh, it's green light, you know. And Canadians are so polite, they don't honk, right? They just go around you. I'm like, thanks be to God, it's Canadian, you know? But you could get into worship as you listen to Christian songs and music. God made music, right? God made music so that we could draw near to Him. And so, but when we worship God in those ways, it takes our hearts away from the things, right, that may not be pleasing to God. And God, He Himself, takes those things away. And so, worship is important. because it draws us near to God, and He makes us holy. Okay? And it's about getting to know God. You know, worship? Yeah. It's about a relationship. You know, He's not just some God who's just far away. You know, He doesn't have a personality, and you know, and I just turn to Him when I need something. God doesn't want that. He wants your heart. You know, He loves us, and He wants us to know His love, right? And we draw close to Him and develop this relationship through worship. Can I ask you, do you have a relationship with God? You know? Are you walking with God? Is He important in your life? Why don't you start that relationship? Open your heart to Him. You know? Begin to pray to Him as you listen to some praise songs. Tell Him just what you're feeling inside. Just the way you are. You don't have to, you know, when you pray, try to sound all holy. Oh, holy art thou, God. You don't have to do that. Just pour out your heart. You come just as you are. You know? When you read the Psalms, man, some of it is a little bit disturbing. Right? God, smite down my enemies. Right? You ever hear that in the Psalm? You know, there it is in the Bible. But the psalm is of prayers of the people, right? And they just come before God as they are. Worship. Worship is a relationship. And it's obedience to God. To obey God. That's where it ends up. Conclusion is that as you come to know God in worship, in your relationship, ultimately, the result is obedience. How do we know we worship God? It's obedience to what He wants. Not what I want. Not my preferences. When in the scripture today, when God says, their hearts are far from me, He's saying the people, they don't care what I want. They don't even care. They're not even looking to me. They're just making up their own rules, their own traditions, and following them, and they think they're worshiping me, but they're not. They don't care about what I want. You see, do you care about what God wants? And do you do it? That's worship. Obedience. And so God says, you know, all these people, they think they're wise, they're making up all these ways of worshiping me and trying to please me. No. You cannot, right? And so God sends Christ. So that the obedience that we cannot do, Christ does. And through Christ, freely, right? We can worship Him in the beginning. But worship, in the end, is obedience. So, in conclusion, God wants you. He loves you. He created you. He knows you. He knows you. He knows your heart. He knows what's best for you. And when we worship Him, we're drawing a little bit closer to God. With our hearts. Okay? For the purpose of listening and obeying Him. And as I said before, true worship is obedience. The heart of worship. seeks to please God. Are there areas in our lives that need obedience? Are there idols that need to be replaced by God in our hearts? Then we must draw near to God and surrender our hearts to Him in worship. Okay? So worship is drawing near to God with our hearts, and it's important because it cleanses us, it purifies us. Okay? So let's pray. Father God,